Chetan Bhagat in conversation with Kartik Kumar. I invite Mr. Bhagat and Mr. Kumar to please take stage.
Good evening, everybody. Thanks for staying for this session. I say that in jest because I know some people have been here from 4 o'clock grabbing seats to make sure that they are at this session. I'm fully aware of this because I feel like I'm in a Bollywood blockbuster right now and I don't have any of my lines in place. So Chetan.
Hi, Kartik.
Who is the half-girlfriend here? Why have they called the session half-girlfriend? I know there's a book. Are you my half-girlfriend?
I can endorse my work. I can take credit for maybe quarter right now, but this half is a little bit too much.
By the evening, I'll make sure you're half.
Okay. So I think just to cut to the chase right away and get everybody into this. I think we stopped the video. Chetan stopped the video. By the way, one of the first things I need to tell you that video is not played by the organizers, but played by Chetan himself. On that front, I must start off with a little bit of narration for about 30 seconds, because before this event happened, Chetan tweeted saying that this session is going to happen, and he happened to add my Twitter handle to it. I've not had so much action on Twitter ever. It's not saying much about my existence, but I've not had so much action on Twitter ever in the last 3 years since my handle has been active. This has been people who have been saying, oh my God, this is going to be the best session ever, to this is going to be the most horrible experience in the universe. So there have been trollers. I mean, that's just gives you an idea of the immense amount of praise and brickbats that this personality faces. So my first question to you, to just kick off the session, because we ended on that lady saying some very interesting comments. How do you handle the praise? How do you process it? And how do you handle the brickbats? Because both are as irrational as the other. My first question.
Okay, well, thank you. Hi, everybody. I am the real messenger of God. Okay. Sorry, I was just watching TV before this session and there's this really cool dude who has made this movie and people are not letting him release it or something. You guys know of this controversy? Is it big in Chennai? Yeah. Anyway, his name is so long, no immigration form in the world can fit it. And Kartik, if you slap someone every day, one morning they'll actually start looking for that slap. So maybe for me, criticism has been such a part of my life that it almost feels odd if it's not there. It's like you go in a crowded bus every day and the bus is not crowded one day. It's kind of like that. So it used to bother me a lot. And I think there is no human being in this world. Anybody who says, oh, it doesn't bother me is lying, or they are not humans, or they've killed a part of themselves. It used to bother me a lot because you create something which you think is good. Others may not like, and they have the right to like it and not like it. But it's like, you know, you cook something, you cook a dish and you taste it and you serve it because you think it's good. Now, people may like it, people may not like it, but you liked it. That's why you made it. And then if people criticize it, obviously you're not going to like it. But over time, with certain, you get used to it, you age, and I think you develop a certain maturity. And the trick of not letting criticism affect you is to not let praise affect you much. So people saying it's the most awesomest session in the world, I mean, they need to get a life because it's not. people therefore saying it's the most horrible experience in the universe, they haven't seen Messenger of God yet. So we don't know. I mean, somewhere in the middle lies the answer, and you just take it lightly after a while and just move on.
On that front, how do you choose the critic or I wouldn't say hater. How do you choose who is the right critic to engage with? Because there's such a volume of criticism out there, and especially on an anonymous medium like Twitter. How do you choose who to engage with, and how do you choose who to absolutely roadblock saying this is the end?
So if it's a pretty girl, usually I'm okay. No, it's, I think seriously, but if I respect them, I think if I respect them at a certain, and it doesn't mean they need to be really successful or famous or anything, if I respect them for their grasp of something, if I respect them that, okay, they understand story or they understand, I don't know, writing, or they understand some aspect, if it's a column, for example, they understand an aspect which I have missed out, then even though I may deny their criticism, in my heart I will know that they had a point. And I have actually engaged with such people, and I have engaged with them a lot to make myself better, actually. Today, I mean, it's a different example, it's not related to my writing, but once some couple of people hacked my website, and they said, look how stupid your website is, we could hack it in 20 minutes. And I said, I was not made it to, like, there's nothing to hack in it, it's just a simple website. But those guys are my web designers today. So, you know, they obviously said, oh, Chetan Bhagat, we hacked your site. I said, then I sent them a mail, hey guys, would you like to be the manage my website? They said, yes, yes, can we come and meet you? So I think you just try to, because I knew that they are good at that, because I knew that they have a point. And same happens with that. I don't let it, and in general in life, you know, it does hurt if 50 people tell you your dress is looking nice, and that one person tells you in a party your dress is not looking nice, you go back home and think of the 51st person only, because that is the human nature. But one should be careful to not give over importance to somebody who has criticized you, because it's impossible to live then, it's impossible. There is a certain belief you need to have in yourself to do anything, actually. So I don't let it affect me. If you are on Twitter a lot, which you are, I think. You see it a lot more. But in normally, it's not there as much. So, and if I know that the criticism is affecting me, I will not write for a while. I'll make sure that it, because it's not good to have something negative in you and then have that feeling, oh, I'm going to show them, and this that is not good. So I let it pass, and yeah, if somebody has some expertise, I do respect them. And if they're cute, even better. So,
I think it would be a very interesting slice of life for all your readers right now to understand one criticism that you took, internalized, and led to a change in any form of an output. Is there something you'd like to share?
Yeah, there is. I mean, people used to say that the books are not edited well. They didn't say it in such nice ways. They said it in much worse, unspeakable ways. But I kind of saw that, okay, can we do something about it? And is Mr. David Davidar here? He was here somewhere. He had a session earlier, but he's gone now. But he works for like Aleph, which is a Rupa joint venture. And he discovered Vikram Seth. He was one of the editors for Half Girlfriend, and we similarly put 7 editors, and each guy had to read it 3 times. So imagine what a pain it was for them. But you know, it was their job, so they couldn't really do much about it. But we took a lot of feedback. I took as much feedback as I could. So today, when the feedback comes that it's not edited well, I will not believe that feedback, because it's nonsense. Because we know how much time we've spent editing it. So that's one example where we did it. There are others also, but I'm still working on those.
I think we started off cutting to the chase because of the fact that we had that lady speak there on the screen. But I think I'm going to start with the journey. Having started off with your first work, which was exactly about 11 years before.
Which you adapted into a play.
Yeah. So
the my connection with Karthik is, I don't know, anybody seen the 5.7 play? Anybody seen it, I've said. If you have seen it, then say no. No, I know many of you have not seen. Please stay. So you think you should stage it again in Chennai? Yeah. It is a beautiful play, and he took my book, and that's how we got to know each other. And I first thought it's not possible. And the play came out much before Three Idiots.
Yeah, much before, yeah, of course.
And I remember it came to Mumbai after Three Idiots. Right. And we were in NCPA watching it, and afterwards, some people said, "Arey, tu pura Three Idiots se copy kara hai." And I was sitting, really? Okay. So, but yeah. So that's the first book you're talking about, 5.1.
Yeah. So 5.1 was an investment banker looking at a change of a life right now. The writing was calling to you. You wrote something that was so beautifully, strongly autobiographical. So did you envision that you will have a fully formed identity as a writer and have to be as prolific as you are right now? Is it something that you envision for yourself? And
No, you can't. And yeah, nobody wanted to publish it either at that time. So I didn't have any notions that this is a beautiful work or anything. It's something I did. I was just so bored. You know, banking is very easy, actually. People make it out to be a big deal, but what is it? It's people keep money in the bank and some people take it to invest and they return it. I mean, it's like, at the end of the day, what is going on there? Arithmetic, right? So, and that too, computers do it nowadays. So it's like sitting on autopilot and acting cool all day. Oh, I'm an investment banker. You are not drilling the holes in the ground to make the oil well or whatever. You're simply saying, you need 500 million, you'll return it? Yeah, okay, take it. I mean, so all the people around me were acting like, oh my God, this is so cool. We're investment bankers, like Goldman Sachs. And I was like, this is so boring. I mean, okay, if it was 500 rupees, it's no big deal. It's 500 million, so it sounds exciting, oh my God. But it's not like I'm giving the money. It's, nothing is happening. So I wrote it just as a hobby. And if I knew it's going to become so big, I would have put more effort into it. And probably never finished it, actually, because I would have been under so much pressure. I think there have been opportunities. That book has mistakes, for sure. And there have been opportunities, of course. We can go back and, just correct those mistakes. But I left them, because that's it. That was me when the 2004, the first book came out. And that rawness, that earnestness in that book, which I think I can never repeat, right? It's a bit like virginity, right? It's gone now. So it doesn't mean you can still have fun, but it's not going to be the same.
I can see that being quoted completely out of context.
This is like the Hindu is like sending SMSs to each other. Who called him again? Okay. It does exist. People know, right? That it exists. And Hindus are supposed to have 4 kids. That's true, no? So if you read the Hindu, you should have 4. Somebody said 5 also. Right? I've never understood. I mean, the point is, okay, I'm assuming it's a strategy for world domination, right? We will totally dominate the world. We'll create those kids. I don't know how we'll get them into school or college and what we'll do. That doesn't matter. Just produce. And but the point is, you have to do others plus 1. If you do 4 and they do 5, it's a wrong message. You must say as many as possible, X plus 1. So. No, sorry, just the Hindu reminded me. Hindus are very like, it's a little, you guys admit, you guys like it, right? It's a serious newspaper. They like it. They like the fact. We are serious, okay? Right? But if they were really cool, they could have written one day of the paper, they could have the Hindu, not, and we have 4 kids or something like that under the masthead. How cool would that be? Anyway, no, please don't do that. I will close your paper down in 3 days. No more lit fests after that.
We're going back to the question. So you had to pull from the autobiographical self for your first book.
Yeah.
When did you fully realize that you are now, you're going to define yourself as a writer? Where is that? Where
no, that's start? Right. So I wrote it and it was like, just like I said, a naive, innocent, cute effort. And it took off and it did well. It didn't instantly took off. It was not an overnight hit, as people say sometimes. It took a year and a half or two for it to really gain traction and people reading it and everything. And then I said, do I have it in me? Or was it just a fluke? And it could have been a fluke because it was on IIT. And there's just so much curiosity about IITs that it was the subject that did it. So I said, let me write about something outside my comfort zone completely. So I wrote on call centers, and that did reasonably okay. I personally feel it's not one of my best works, but whatever, I did it. And then I thought, okay, maybe again it did well because it's call centers and that's hot right now. So I thought, now let me try something totally disconnected, which is when I did the Three Mistakes of My Life or the Kai Poche, which had nothing to do with any genre or any like TG or anything like that. And that also, when three books did well, I thought, okay, they like this. So I can do whatever I want and whatever story I like. And there are people who will like to read them. It doesn't matter that I write only about IITs or IIMs or anything. So I think after three books, and that's exactly when I left my career as a banker. It wasn't a very good career anyway, but a lot of people say, oh, you left your investment, high-flying investment banking job. It wasn't high-flying at all. They wouldn't promote me. Always it was like performance reviews, meets, does not meet. Do you guys have performance reviews, any of you? Yeah, what's this deal of does not meet expectations? Isn't that the boss's problem? They should lower their expectations. You know, what is it my problem? So all that was happening. So, and three books are doing well, really well. And in banking, I'm like not doing well. And I am, but you know, one amazing thing happened right at that time, 2008 and 9, there was a huge recession. Some subprime crisis and everything. I didn't do anything that year anyway. I was just like so busy with books. So everyone in my team invested and they lost 60% on an average. I did nothing. So I was flat. I had full cash at the end of the year. So that year I got a good performance review. they said he has shown restraint. But I knew that I didn't have it in me. And you know, I still remember the day. There was a deal we were working on and the client came and all the bankers were sucking up to him and he was like a big promoter. And they said, sign this term sheet, sign the deal. He said, I'll sign it, but first he has to sign books for my kids first. And I was like, wow, man, it has reached the shores of the bank now. So I can think about leaving. So that's when I left.
I don't know if we will be able to come back to 5 points someone during the course of this 45 minutes, but I must share with you something very, very significant, which is very personal. Just bringing that play to stage, it was first staged by the Madras Players and we were happy to produce the play. And then we had to readapt it again and create another adaptation which could tour across the country. And yes, it was there were collapsible units that we couldn't put together because it had to be a coherent play within 2 hours and 45 minutes. So it was not, there had to be a lot of elements that we had to remove. But every time we staged the play, you should see the simplicity of the thought reaching the audience much before the actors themselves have felt it. And you should see that circuit closure that happens in theater where the audience completes a thought that is started off on stage. And that happened so much because it was, I think, somewhere reflecting the Indian ethos. And I saw young kids, two people who have studied in the IITs in the 60s, who came in and watched that play and felt that circuit closure happening. So I don't know if the virginity can be revisited, but that was magnificent.
I think it was a compliment. So thank you.
Editorial style.
Yeah.
Most importantly, as a prolific creator right now who sees yourself delivering a book once in 2 years, two seasons, so to speak, how different are the pressures today? How do you define those pressures? What do you take on as a definable pressure as a writer?
Yeah, actually, I have been prolific and I have not been prolific. I've slowed it down now. Like, Half Girlfriend came after 3 years and I'm just a little more relaxed. And I don't want to do something which I don't want to do, really, like from the inside. And there is pressure, for sure. And to come up with new things, but at the end of the day, they want me to, the expectation is that you should write something completely new. But if certain essentials of a Chetan Bhagat book are not there, that's also a problem. So, but that's why the idea is to take a break and not write, not be as prolific. From 1.5 to 2 years, I've slowed it down to 3 years, which adds a whole extra year. So that will allow me to think carefully, and I try not to think of the pressure. But it's, yeah, it's there. I'm sure it's there. That's why I told you the virginity is gone. Now she has to perform.
What do you think are the essentials of a Chetan Bhagat book that you feel that your readers expect and identify with continuously?
No, I mean, I don't know, but they do. I actually, that's a question I'd ask the readers mainly. But I think the stories have to be about India. It's about ordinary lives in India. Now, Indians are not that exciting at the end of the day, right? I have written as much excitement was there. So I have to find new things. And that's what. So the fact that the stories have to be very rooted in reality and yet be very exciting, that's the essential requirement. And the rest will be there, like the style of writing and all is not going to change even if I want to. So that's, yeah.
I'm going to linger a little more on that because you worked on Kick and you probably saw a Bollywood actor on an Eid release and the pressures that go with a Bollywood release, all right? And your books now at the stage of the career that you are no smaller than a Bollywood release and the pressures that accompany it. I think you're being too modest. I think if I were you, I would be incredibly aware of all of those expectations. How do you handle them now?
I am aware, but you know, I'm older than you now, you know. So as you get older, there is a certain maturity and detachment, I guess, or something kicks in. So it matters and it doesn't really matter. That's what the beginning of, I guess that's, I don't want to call it spirituality because that's, I'm not sure if I can really say I'm that right now, but I want to do it for myself. If I wanted to do Half Girlfriend, I loved that story for myself. If people liked it, it's great. If they didn't like it as much, maybe I can listen to it. But at the end of the day, I'm very proud I did it. So it doesn't matter, is the answer. It doesn't matter so much. I guess I'm secure enough now. And I think whenever I've done that, it has always worked. That, you know, I want to do it, so I'll do it. I don't want to do it because, oh, what will people... Because if you start thinking about that, millions are going to read this, you'll never be satisfied with it, right? You'll always want to say, no, this is not good enough, so...
We are at the Lit Fest, so I must be very, very aware of the fact that I think literature is heralded and deconstructed to the greatest degree at a festival like this. Wow. Subject, I said that very well, didn't I?
Yeah, you are really good at all.
I know, I was not listening to your answer, I was rehearsing.
This is like, I have to learn to talk like that. It just sounds like something impressive he has said. Right? It just sounds. Nobody knows fully what he meant. But the moment you say, you know, we need to deconstruct and relook at the vision of society.
I should write a book.
I think you totally should. Or join politics. It's the season right now.
It's the season, yeah.
Right? I feel like today I was just wrote, it's like the entire, you know, I'm very happy that Anna's, the entire class of Anna has been placed now. Right? So, very happy. It's a good, you know, everybody's got their place and it's nice. Full placement, you know.
On that front,
I'm not getting placed. I'm very happy out of placement.
But you do realize that there is speculation that you will be in politics very soon, and they've already decided that for you.
I got a waistcoat. I have the one requirement I meet, but that's about the only one. I'm so irreverent. I'll say something foolish every day. If I join, I'll say I have 8 kids or something, you know. It's like, I'll say like practice having kids or something like that. Let me show you how. I know. So, I think, you know, on a serious note, it's great that good people are joining politics because that's the only way it's going to change, right? Good people. And why are they joining? Because, of course, whatever the political chess moves, they are joining because the political parties are forced to take them. They know that they need faces which are credible, they need faces from society which are respected, and that is the churning process happening. I have never needed political power. I have never craved it also. And I think I don't need it. I mean, there are people who are very good, but they may not have the reach. They may not have the reach like I have. So for them, a political post may help. So they can join. Because there are some downsides to joining too, which is the biggest one is you lose your independence. You have to say things in line with that party, which today very few people can, you know, and who are well known also. How many people are there that are very well known, but they talk about politics also? Very few. I mean, the Bollywood actors don't. They are very popular, but they don't. So very, very few people. So I think the value of apolitical people is also there in society. It's good. I don't need placement. So.
Since you have ventured upon this topic, I think I'd like to linger on that a little more. You are now a complete media personality, right? From being quoted on topics that concern India today, about the youth and what the youth, young people think. Where does that personality exist vis-a-vis the writer?
Vis-a-vis the right?
Vis-a-vis the writer. I mean, is that...
Right or right wing?
No, the writer.
Writing. Oh, yeah. Sorry, I thought you're talking about politics.
So you're now, you're a complete public personality.
It's been helpful, of course, because it allows me to be more known to people and it allows me different mediums, you know, and I'm comfortable with it, basically. I'm comfortable with television or with films and everything. And I believe medium is not important, right? It's the communication that needs to happen. So whether I'm tweeting something or whether I'm putting it in a book or in a column or discussing it in a national debate, it's same. Basic content is the same. So that way, I've always had that view. That is why my identity as a writer is not as much, frankly. But books remain at the heart of it. All these things are there only because of the books. My primary readers, they like my books, basically. I thought once Bollywood films come, people will just get so glamour struck, they'll forget about the books. It didn't happen. When Half Girlfriend came out, the excitement was as much as a movie adaptation or whatever. So that has, in fact, taught me a lot that the books are the crux. So it's more like they're at the center and then all these things happen around it. And it's important because different writers are writing for different reasons, you know, and that is the beauty. You would see it if you attend the session all day here, you'll see all kinds of writings, all kinds of intentions of writers. So for me, it is a means for change. For others, it could be, for example, to perfect the art of writing because it's an art form. And there's nobody who's to judge what is right and what is not. So for me, in a country like India, everybody doesn't read books. So you have to do other mediums. But the downside, of course, is that it can dilute you. It can take attention away from writing. So I limit it. I try to limit it.
Do you feel like, I mean, since you believe that there are many things that you need to change about the country as a citizen, as a strong citizen with an opinion, do you feel responsible right now that your characters need to speak those things in the book? Do they have to do some kind of samaj sudharak work?
Yeah, that's a very sad thing, because that what happens is that people first they say, oh Chetan, aap to youth icon ho gaye and aap to mark darshan kariye. The scariest is when people, you know, like the Chetan Ji, the moment you become a Chetan Ji, you know, the G is in trouble. Because then they'll say, and then the moment you write a book about a boy who's, I don't know, wants to make out with a girl, Chetan Ji, aap kya sikha rahe ho bachcho ko? Main nahi sikha raha. Mera kaam, main teacher nahi hu. I'm a writer and I'm here to write stories and it's a reflection. Are boys not making out with girls in society? They are. So if they make out in a story, it's not unreal. The story has to reflect reality. But then, Chetan Ji, aap aisa kar rahe ho. And aap to adarsh hai. So that is why I started doing columns, actually. Because all the gyanbazi you do there, no, leave the book for fun. If people, little bit can be there, a little bit, you know, like say two states, okay, you know, you should not discriminate on community, for example. But it's very like little bit over there. That's also very irreverent book. So that much is okay. If you go to a bar and you order a drink and someone gives you a glass of milk, what will you do? You'll slap that person, right? But if he gives you a drink and some almonds and says, have this, this is good for you, you won't mind it. So that is the approach of writing I have. Change will happen, but change cannot be shoved down as gyan, especially with young people. It should not be. It is done in a way that it's in a very gradual sort of way. So I spend half my time explaining this only to people. Like there was a line in Half Girlfriend where the boy says something to a girl. He's just so frustrated. I don't want to repeat that line here. But the character in the book is saying it. But they're like, they labeled me as the guy who's saying it, or you know, which is very strange. But you know, that's why it's tough. So that I'm not, I say I'm not a youth icon actually. I don't want to be. Firstly, look at this. Is youth? This is, huh? Secondly, okay, I agree I'm younger than Rahul Gandhi, and if Rahul Gandhi is youth, then I'm youth. So that's fine. So I'm that way youth. But if you want a youth icon who will tell you, I'm not a saint. I'm not here to tell you, do live like this. I'm not messenger of God. I really am not. But if you want a youth icon who's real and who does not believe that having fun is bad, who believes that you should be sincere more than serious in life, you know, that's then maybe you've come to the right place. But if you're looking for Adarsh Purush, then you should go to Karthik. He's the Adarsh Purush.
Why me?
Are you the Adarsh Purush?
Only comparatively, I think.
Right? Comparatively.
On the stage,
it's right? Grey. 50 shades of... Never. They're never allowing us on the bullet.
I have I think it's very current right now in the country right now. As writers, as performers, as people who speak an artistic opinion out there, there is a sense of there will be a fundamentalist group that will be talking about it. There was a very recent issue about a very leading writer called Perumal Murugan.
Just now.
Who has now declined to define himself as a writer henceforth because he's been trolled and he's been harassed for his, not his opinion, but his depiction of his characters. I think that's a very relevant topic today as to what can be said and what cannot be said, and the young people are taking a cue from that. What do you think is taboo for you to say as Chetan Bhagat, the writer?
Firstly, I'm the writer you just mentioned, Mr. Perumal. How do you pronounce
it? Perumal Murugan.
Yeah. So, Mr. Perumal Murugan, I am with you. Let it be known. I am sorry that you felt so anguished that you don't want to write again. But actually, now is the time to write. Now is the time to write what you felt. Now is the time to write, and because that's the weapon you have. And if you don't feel safe, then go to the state government and say, I don't feel safe. I need protection, and they'll give you protection. But you don't stop writing, because that is a defeat. So if people think I have never got threats, then that's wrong. I've been now, 3-4 years ago, if I've been writing against the ruling family or things like that, which was a no-go zone for people in the media even. Now, towards the end, when they know that they're losing, everybody took a free-for-all. But I'm talking 3 to 4 years back. I'm talking Commonwealth Games scam time. And it's not easy. Like, it's not easy. My mother used to say, what are you doing? Why do you have to do this and this? And you manage and you try your best not to be safe and everything, but you can't stop writing. This is not that country where people can just stop you from writing. This is a free country. This is a democracy. If somebody has done that, they are criminals. That they have harassed you, they have intimidated you. you don't like it, you don't read it, you know, it's fine. And I, the same applies to the other way also. Today I'm also supporting Messenger of God. I really am. I'm not seeing the film and I'm not going to give a recommendation on the film. But you cannot say that you will not let it release. It's been passed by the censors now, I heard. So if it has been passed, it has been passed. Now, I can make a movie. If I want to show myself as Superman, I can make it. As long as I have a good colored underwear, it's okay. Right? So, which I wear outside. But I'm just saying, so it's very sad. And I think it has happened. It still happens in 2014. Is very shocking to me, because how can I've told this to politicians also when they were trying to stop Twitter. I remember in the we were on another panel, and in the green room they were discussing how to control social. Firstly, I said you can't control social media, so try as your best. You can't even make IRCTC run. How will you run control social media, right? So, but. First you book a ticket on IRCTC, then we'll control social media. So, in the first try, try and book it on the first try. And you know, the thing is, if you make one error, the whole form gets deleted. Who put that? You know what? Out of 20 fields, one pin code was missing. Fill it all up again. It's like somebody's such a sadist, right? Somebody who didn't get a promotion in the government. He said, I'm going to make like hell for millions of Indians every day. So I said, you know, in Indians, the one thing, Indians suffer a lot, right? We take so much nonsense from our governments, right? We surrender ourselves. We allow them to make our cities that are crumbling, traffic jams every day. We still get on with it. We go to work. Like if tomorrow we have bad roads in Chennai, the whole of Chennai stops going to work for 1 week, they'll fix it. But we don't. We like, it's okay, chalo kar lenge. But the one thing you can't take away from us is our love for talking and gossip. And things like that, we cannot take away that right of Indians. It is just going to backfire on you. So, because that's how we cope. We cope by, you know, that's our catharsis. So you cannot stop Indians from talking. Just as in France it's there, it's almost there in us also. We are not as liberal as the French, but quite there. The only place we are not as liberal is maybe religion, maybe the things that makes babies, doctors and nurses, of course. So that is we are. But even that is collapsing now. Lot of, at least I would find, in my religion, for example, there's a lot of tolerance, usually. Like there have been movies coming all the time, and but in, it's still not as much as it can be, I feel. So I think we cannot take away this right. So he should join. Now is the time for him to. He can't do this. I mean, that's not. You can't choose not to be a writer. He may not publish a book, but the writer in him will never go away. He can't. It's not a job you can resign from. You know? Sorry, sir. It's not happening. I'm with you and I'm going to make sure he writes again. So.
I think one of the key things that young people identify with in your books is the fact that the protagonist, usually with whom we travel during the course of the book, are not, the word would be ordinary, would be flawed, would be imperfect, and therefore seeking perfection in their own flawed way, and then meandering through the film through the book towards a higher purpose. All right, now. I think the fact that your protagonists are flawed, first identify and put a balm on those young people saying it's okay to be what you are, all right? So therefore, today, I mean, 10 years from your first book right now, the protagonist is still a youngster, but has that youngster's problems or challenges changed over the last 10 years? Is Madhav significantly different from Hari?
Well, yes and no. I mean, in the sense, he's still a young Indian boy. But what I have done in 10 years is maybe reached places which I would have dreamt of, I've not have dreamt of doing 10 years ago. Doing Hari 5.1 was easy for me because IIT, that's the life I've lived 4 years. Doing Madhav Jha at that time, a rural Bihar boy, is impossible. I didn't know. I mean, and today I feel confident that I can do it because I know a little bit about it. So just the milieu, the setting, wise, Madhav is very different from Hari, so therefore his problems are very different. He is also flawed to the extent that even though it's a love story, he's almost crass, and he's not respectable, not respecting the woman he loves because he just doesn't know. But that's real. That's a real aspect of how sometimes people are if they have no experience with women or dating and everything. That's how sometimes guys are. So I think all those aspects, I am not like, I'm not from that background. Some of the things I cannot relate to, but I'm able to do it today. It was, and also what has changed is, I think 10 years ago, engineering was this mecca. Engineering medicine was a mecca. Today, Madhav Jha is not aspiring to be an engineer. He works in an NGO. The professions have changed, which kind of maybe if you, now that you talk, I'm thinking about it, that the professions have become more widespread. Whereas in the earlier books, they were the traditional engineer, MBA, banker. So I think that's changed.
And you talked about the baby making aspect of it. I think you're cautious. I mean, you're on that exciting line because popular fiction for young people never ever stepped into that area without being absolutely arty or intellectual about it. And therefore it spoke about that awkwardness from a very awkward perspective. Today, the young person, what is the challenge in that space? I mean, is there...
Well, the big difference also has been that I became a father in the last 10 years. So my kids were born when 5.7 came out. Exactly, my age as an author is same as my kids. So 10 years my kids are, and they are already reading books, like they read Harry Potter and stuff like that. So they are just almost ready to read my words, but I'm not letting them because who knows, they may not like me after that or whatever. So, you know, I'm like, I want to keep my kids, like I want them to like their father a little longer. So, so I'm aware that, you know, and I'm also aware that the books have become so widespread that a lot of youngsters are reading it. So I don't want to make them very explicit. But at the same time, I don't want to hold back the story either. I don't want to be like, and then two flowers met on the table, you know, that's like stupid. So I'm kind of toned down the language. What I do is I make girls read it. And if they say it's icky, because guys often write, what guys think is very romantic is not romantic actually. So then they say, what is this? And then chick, 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 it goes off. And then if the girl approves it, then the girls are approving it, then it stays in the book. So that's normally a good test to do love making scenes. Let's not call it like baby making scenes. Nobody has made babies in my book yet. So. But yeah, so those, I think that's the one I do. I often say that I think it's better if young, and I don't think there's anything wrong, as it's better that you see that two people who are in love or you two characters you know really well are doing it. It may be more hard-hitting, but it's much better than sexual imagery that comes as a, you know, just a bang item number. And then you have a five-year-old girl at home watching it, and she's also dancing in the same way at the next party. I mean, it's a little disturbing. It happens. We all know it happens. It's much better that once they can read a book, and they read that this boy and a girl liked each other, and after knowing each other for several months, they may be kissed or whatever. And I think that's perfectly natural, normal way of teaching things. But what they see in cinema, and that comes to our TVs, is very bothersome, actually. It's very disturbing, I feel. Like this is, they'll have a very warped idea of what sexuality is. And so I think it needs to be there. The solution to it is not that you just obliterate all references to it. Nobody told us. Did anyone tell you? Did your parents actually sit you down and say,
this Mother is right here, so I don't want to answer that question. Right,
okay. No, nobody tells you. Then you rent out a video one day and, you know, that, I mean, that's not the way it should be. I think we can learn to talk about it in a nice way. It's important because the kids are going to be curious about it anyway. And with so much content on the internet and everything, it's better you give them a navigation map. Otherwise, it's trouble.
All right, I'm going to take a turn into a different topic right now. And recently, there was a very, very beautiful film heralding the combat between a producer. I mean, there's a film called Saving Mrs.
Can you show that to everybody, please? Do it now.
Yeah, actually.
Return it. You see the pressure we have to go through?
Saving Mrs.
You
Banks.
You guys actually printed it and made banners about it. 10. What if you miss out that 10th minute then? And then, okay. Yeah.
So there was a movie about called Saving Mrs. Banks, which talks about the making of Mary Poppins into a movie.
Yeah.
All right? And you have been involved as a writer on movies that came from your books that you were not part of the writing team. And subsequently were a part of the writing team and now have been a part of a writing team of a direct movie itself. The questions of objectivity as a writer when you're translating your own work onto screen, when somebody else is translating onto screen, how has that journey been? How has that process?
I mean, it's mostly been good. There were some hiccups, as many of you know it. Some of them were public spats, especially when Three Idiots happened, and that was unfortunate. But luckily, that was a long time ago. Now they have made another film and I have done several films and a lot of... I think Bollywood is different. I mean, it's very difficult to... Anyway, we are talking of English book converted to a Hindi movie. So anyway, it's not as simple an adaptation as a Hollywood adaptation where everything is same. Here, it's very different. You have to make musicals out of English novels, you know, with six songs and everything. So it's difficult. So in a sense, you have to be prepared that some of it will be lost. I've always had the view that, you know, the story exists in a cloud, like a cloud computing. And the book is also not the story, actually. The book is also where the story was told. There was a world, and that has been captured in the book. And now that same world will be captured in a movie and stage. And so you have to approach it that way. If you only look at this was there in book, this is not there in movie, it'll be very uncomfortable because it's not going to happen that way. So once you have that approach, then you work on what's there in the cloud that must happen in the movie. And I try to tell them that, but it's very collaborative and therefore it is difficult for a writer. Because when I'm writing a novel, I can kill characters, I can do whatever I want. There, it's... Five or six people have a say in every scene. And on the day of the shooting also, they will change the scene. So what to do? And so there is a lot of dilution that happens. And but you just have to say, like, you know, it's like playing tennis versus cricket. It's like a solo game versus a team game. And it's a different, you sync with the team. You know, it doesn't matter, right? How the captain manages you and all matters in cricket. So that's... two different approaches. I enjoy books more. I do like films, but I still enjoy books more because of that reason, because it's too collaborative and too many. So you have a certain, as a writer, I'm used to imagining a story completely. Like, I know that this is what happens. Now four people come and say, no, but maybe they should not meet here, they should meet there because that's a cheaper location. I mean, it's fact of life. And I'm like, no, but in my story, they meet here. So then I said, okay, it's a cheaper location, okay, but what am I trying to do? They meet and set up a date, okay, fine. So that, it takes a while to get used to that.
I think from one night at a call center to I think you were particularly excited about the version that Kai Poche was of
yeah.
Three Mistakes.
I think it's beautiful.
What do you think did not suffer in translation and in fact enhanced it? What did you feel?
I think it's like a beautiful adaptation because I thought it's a very difficult book to adapt, firstly. It's a very complex story. It was not a very commercial story to begin with because it's a Godhra riots and everything, and those kind of movies never really make money. So, but it did. It did reasonably well. Then we couldn't get a casting for it. That's why we took absolutely new guys. So they went on with it and still made it. And I think what it captured well and what almost even the book can't do is the Gujarati. Because the book is in English and it's a Hindi movie, but it had those smatterings of Gujarati, the language, and the music and everything which comes, which gives a different ethnic and local feel to this. And that was done very well. The performances were very, very understated by Bollywood standards. Everybody acted really, because they were new, they worked really hard. And I think it just became a really special film. I mean, I don't know how many of you seen Kai Poche here? Many of you have, great. So I think it means something else in Tamil though. His hand is gone or something, no? I told them it's not the most user-friendly name, but they liked it, so.
It rhymes with something worse.
5 minutes to go. So we have questions or what? 5 minutes. Do you see the 5 minutes one?
I'm sorry.
He has a 5 minutes also. How many? You have one also? No?
5 minutes to audience.
5 minutes to questions or 5 minutes to go? To go, to finish. 5 minutes to go,
5 minutes to send you out, I think.
Yeah. Okay. It's the last session, but we are just moving to the questions.
I have two questions. I'll start with the simpler one. Okay. And I know I'm going to get a politically correct answer on this. I hope not. Would you sign off on the screenplay of Kick and say that's a Chetan Bhagat book?
Well, it's not a Chetan Bhagat book because I'm not the only screenplay writer on it. It's as it should be. It has Rajat Arora, who does dialogues and who's brilliant and does very good Hindi dialogues. He's done all the dialogues in that one. And there is the director himself, Sajid Nadidwala, and there is another assistant, Keith Combs, who was there. So, no, because it was not written as a Chetan Bhagat book. It was written, Kick is very different. Kick is not even a typical adaptation of mine. Because those are driven by story. Kick is what they call a star vehicle in Hollywood, which is, it's a Salman Khan movie. It has to be about Salman Khan. It has to be about making Salman Khan's happy. So it just wouldn't work as a book. So that was the idea. And if you notice, Kick has everything. It has home and... in fact, when we were making Kick, I remember I said, people like Salman for two things. One, they like him as an action guy who beats people up, bad guys. And then they like him as that prem in that. These are the two things. If we made an all-out action, it's very different. You're competing with Mission Impossible and all that. But if we bring both in one movie, how it could work? And therefore, you know, Salman has that whole angle of living with the family, going in there, all those, Salman being Salman at home, Salman being an action outside, and these two guys, Devi and Devil, were there. So it's designed for Salman. So it's like saying, you know, would you take a custom-made suit and put it up in a ready-made rack? You can't. It's a ready-made, it's a custom script, and only Salman can carry it off.
Alex had that answer. I think for the last question of the day before we throw it open to the audience, the usual route for a writer in the Indian scheme of things is to do your literature when you're graduating, read a lot of, start with the Enid Blytons and move to the understanding of the Robert Louis Stevensons and all the great works and all of that. And then they have this intense pressure of living up to an ideal that they've created and they write their first book. What was your role model in the route of becoming a writer? And today, what is your role model in the world out there to for the next 10 years? What do you want to be in the next 10 years?
No, I also did the same route to a certain extent. Maybe I was not a English major and not a total bookworm, but I have been reading books. And I'd always be attracted to simple stories. So you do start with Enid Blyton. But I remember when I read Animal Farm, for example, or I really felt what a like amazing concept and so simple and so much impact this book has had. Or Catch 22. Or even Charles Dickens' works, Jane Austen's works, about people. I just really liked it that those stories I used to love the most, stories about people. And that I guess, became more to me. And I think when you have a story to tell, when you feel genuine emotion and you can express the genuine emotion, the language doesn't matter, actually. If something bad, God forbid, happens to a person and you're expressing remorse, they lose someone or whatever, what moves you? The way they express it, the way the emotion moves you, it's not like how well they express their vocabulary over there. And that's what moves people. So, yes, it's nice to have a good control of language to a certain degree that you are articulate. But beyond that, it's for your personal pleasure. That, okay, it's an art form. I really want to be my language to be also superlative. But after a certain point, it doesn't matter. You need to have a certain standard. It doesn't mean it doesn't matter. But beyond a point, it doesn't. It's just then you being a connoisseur. So I think that's what I've always believed in, that people and their emotions, that's what makes great stories for me. But everybody is different. Like I said, there are different writers and they have a different approach. I like people, so I write about people.
And your role model going forward right now, I mean, do you have people you look up to saying, that's who I'd like to be 10 years from now? What would you like to be remembered as a writer?
I don't really have. I mean, there are many people. I mean, someone like you, I'm not kidding, okay? Someone like you inspires me. You did something totally different. Anybody who wants to create a change and has the courage to do something different, you wanted to bring theater, you succeeded at it, to a Mark Zuckerberg, to a Steve Jobs. I mean, I know they are not writers, but there is something inspiring about the way they wanted to change the world. And I don't know, I've said this, I don't want to be remembered, I want to be missed, you know? So.
On that note of changing the world, I think we will throw the floor to questions from the audience, so.
Yeah, we can do only a few because it's the time is up, so we'll do a few.
I'm teaching one of your novels for my students.
Oh wow,
but
thank you.
Blatantly saying, it was very difficult for me to include it in a college syllabus, but I did it.
Thank
because
you.
The so-called stalwarts of my institution told me that Chetan Bhagat's book, they don't have this literary value. Then I wondered, I wanted to ask this question when I got this opportunity. Now I'm asking you, brother, where does the distinction between canonical text or literature fiction and commercial text, according to you, brother?
I don't know, I mean, you know, I don't know what is literary value. I don't even know what it means. If I would think, I'm not saying if it's my book, I would think if a writer has come in a certain generation and been read by a lot of people and they are reading a lot of his works, then that person needs to be studied. Sometimes you can add value by just if people read you and understand how bad you are. You know, so I think this, it sounds a little elitist when people say this has value and this doesn't. Time decides that. And I'm still current, you know. Classics have an advantage. They've been written long back and they've stood the test of time. So compared to the classics, I obviously don't have any value. But they have been, you are talking of the five books that are remaining for 100 years. So yes, compared to them, no. But, you know, I'm not writing for literary value really. I want to write books that people enjoy, and if you felt it has value, then don't let anybody else tell you that, right? You are a teacher yourself, so.
Perspicuously manifesting, I think God deserves a great felicitation for mooting this idea in the Hindu to give you this chance to be with us. And shall we all give a big rousing applause, gentlemen and ladies?
Thank you.
And the Hindu has succeeded in unfolding a new Chetan Bhagat.
Thank you.
Welcome. Mr. Chetan Bhagat, I got a question for you. You have just ventilated the thought that you ignore criticism. And I know whether you ignore the constructive criticism.
You should not let it affect you, but you should not ignore it either. And constructive criticism is very important. I mean, that's what I live on. And I'm anyway the kind of person who takes a lot of feedback and not just for writing, in life. I mean, there are so many places there is scope, but you have to very quickly know whether it's constructive or not. The problem is 90% is not constructive, only 10% is constructive.
Yeah. Can I ask you a question?
Sure, ma'am.
About Perumal Murugan. You said, I promised to make him write. Are you in earnest? Was that?
Well, I mean, I cannot. Just as nobody can force him to not write, nobody can force him to write. But I am hoping and I am confident that if my words reach him and if a lot of, it's not just me, so many people are supporting him, he will pick up a pen again.
But his situation is different from yours. You are an elite writer, he is not. And
how am I elite? I just had no literary value, he said. There is nothing like that. I don't... He is being discussed here. He's become a national issue. He's a very important.
But he stopped writing because he was not commercially.
No, he didn't stop writing because it was not commercially.
He couldn't do anything else. But and if he were as famous as you, he could have, taken another way out. But
I don't think it's driven by that. I think that's a separate issue. But I think if he's worried, if he feels some people are not with him, I just want him to know that I'm with him. That's all. And hopefully if all of us say that, he will write again. How does it matter who's more and who's not? It's about he's right and others are wrong. And when you are right, the level of fame or commercial success doesn't matter.
So my question is, one time you went out to stream was with what Young India wants, but then you never went on to touch such topics again. Is it because you thought what Young India wants is a Salman Khan wedding?
No, I'll do everything. I can't only bato gyan every day. If people like my stories, I like writing stories, people like reading my stories. So I want to do a love story sometimes. Sometimes I don't want to give gyan to people. Nobody can give gyan all the time. Some people who pretend, they are actually pretending. So I want to have fun also. I want to do fun stuff. And every now and then I will do. So I have been writing my columns since. It's just that it's not come as a book. But it's a balance I try to do. But I will do something like that again soon.
I've recently started reading your books from 5 point someone to half girlfriend. I've gone the back, from half girlfriend I started to 5 point someone. So from Sasi's Parathas to half girlfriend, where he goes to the 5-star hotel. From the point where he sleeps with his professor's.
Darling, question to Didam.
Yeah. No. Do you want, my question is just stating what you have stated. Okay. Are you trying to show that India is changing and are you trying to be the catalyst of change in India?
Maybe I'm not the catalyst. I'm trying for it to change. But the books, if you talk, they will capture the changing times. If you remember my earlier books, they used to have STD booths and people calling late at night. Now, there is cell phones and WhatsApps and things like that. So it's, but I have not changed that. I have not created these changes. I'm just observing what has changed. So definitely you will see that happening now.
Chetan, do you really have the time to read the mail?
We'll do this and this lady and then politely we will end the session.
Yeah. Do you really have the time to read the mailbox which fans post on a website?
Yeah, I do.
Yeah. Do you really consider those comments and
I do. Yeah. I mean, if it's worthwhile comments.
Yeah. Okay.
Not all. Yeah, but obviously. Yeah, we do. And I have a team, they print it out for me and I see it. And sometimes I have it on my phone also. Yeah.
Okay. Thanks.
So, hi. My name is Neha. And on that note, I'll ask you something. Is there any significance or special connection you use the name in your novel?
Name?
Yeah, my name is Neha.
Oh, Neha.
Yeah.
I really like that name. It was there in the first book, yeah. I like to keep simple short names, it also saves typing.
Okay.
If your name was, what is his name, yeah, the MSG guy? His name is very long. Yeah, so if I write a book about this person, imagine the number of times I'll have to write it. So, no, it's a nice, sweet name. It's a very popular Delhi name, actually.
No, is there anything, something, special to you other than being a common name?
Let's not open wounds, Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for the session. Thank you so much for your patience.